Any magical historian could tell you that the wizarding world spans books, films, a Broadway play, and J.K. Rowling's unstoppable Twitter updates. Hey everyone, this is Jacob with Cinematica, and we're writing a history lesson of our own with a Harry Potter timeline. This video will cover the original 8 films with a focus on the decades-long struggle between Harry and Voldemort, though there's a bunch of stuff that happens before the decades-long part.
I read about it in Hogwarts. History.
I'm sure you did, Hermione, but that means no Fantastic Beasts and no Cursed Child, thankfully, so maybe this'll be a little less comprehensive than Hogwarts of History, but I'm sure many would agree that might be for the better. And never mind the Hogwarts Express for now, because we're twisting our time turner way back to 1,000 years ago. Circa the 900s to around the 1300s. In the 10th century, 4 of the leading witches and wizards of England establish Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry. They are Godric Gryffindor, Helga Hufflepuff, Rowena Ravenclaw, and Salazar Slytherin. They each found a schoolhouse that embodies their respective personalities. Unfortunately, Slytherin's personality turns out to be bigoted fascist, so it isn't long before he mucks up the whole system. He believes that only pure-blooded wizards are suitable for mentorship at Hogwarts, causing a fallout between him and the other founders. He retires, but not before building the Chamber of Secrets and placing a basilisk inside so that one day his heir can free it and purge the school of half-bloods and muggleborns. Good, cool stuff! Such a cool thing to do, my dude! Hundreds of years later, in the 1200s, the 3 Peverell brothers come into possession of 3 tools that are immensely OP. Dubbed the Deathly Hallows, they are the Invisibility Cloak, the Resurrection Stone, and the Elder Wand, and it's believed that the brothers received them from Death himself. As Death claims each of the brothers' lives, the items are lost to time. Later that very same century, the Triwizard Tournament is founded. Hogwarts participates in the tournament, along with its fellow wizarding schools, the Durmstrang Institute and Beauxbatons Academy of Magic, which is ridiculous since that school is in France and should be pronounced Beauxbatons, but I digress. 100 years after that, the French alchemist Nicolas Flamel, or Nicholas Flamel, I guess, creates a massively powerful piece of magic called the Philosopher's Stone, which, sidebar, Flamel was a real person who lived from about 1330 to 1418, and the Philosopher's Stone is an actual mythological item that is actually called the Philosopher's Stone and is not the Sorcerer's Stone, as American audiences were led to believe. The copy I've had since I was a kid says Philosopher's Stone, and this is a hill I will gladly die on. Extra points to Full Metal Alchemist for not needlessly changing the name of the Philosopher's Stone, and if you want to watch that timeline, you can find it over on our sister channel, Gettin' the Robot. Sidebar over. Anyway, Flamel uses the stone to create an elixir of life that sustains him for hundreds of years. Its life-giving properties are far more effective than those of unicorn blood. He lasts longer than the Triwizard Tournament, which ends in 1792 after the tradition is deemed to be too dangerous. And we very plainly see why in the Goblet of Fire, but I'm getting way ahead of myself. 1899. So anyway, like 100 years later, in 1899, the young wizard Gellert Grindelwald is expelled from the Durmstrang Institute after performing dark experiments and attacks on students. Post-expulsion, Grindelwald goes to live with his great-aunt Bathilda Bagshot, who introduces him to her neighbor, Albus Dumbledore. The two boys cultivate a close and complicated friendship, which later turns romantic, built on ambition and their shared aptitude for magic. Though you'd never know the romantic part if you were just watching the movies. They soon begin plotting a wizarding revolution by finding the Deathly Hallows and bringing an end to the International Statute of Secrecy, but Albus has responsibilities that he's choosing to ignore. Specifically, after his mother's death, he and his younger brother Aberforth were left as the main caregivers to their young and vulnerable sister, Arianna. When Aberforth confronts Albus about his dereliction of duty, Grindelwald steps in and uses the Cruciatus Curse on the young wizard. Albus is horrified by the use of one of the unforgivable curses, and the 3 wizards begin to duel. Arianna gets caught in the crossfire, is struck by a spell, and dies. 1926 to 1943. On New Year's Eve of 1926, Tom Marvolo Riddle was born to a witch mother and muggle father who got mixed up in this business against his will. Riddle's mother cast a love spell on him. Through his mom, Merope Gaunt, he's the direct heir of Salazar Slytherin, but his upbringing isn't so lofty. Since his mother died and his father is out of the picture, he's raised at Wool's Orphanage in London. Dark happenings follow Tom. On holiday at a seaside cave, he traumatizes some of his fellow orphans. In 1938, Hogwarts professor Albus Dumbledore, who has aged pretty ungracefully since his youth as Jude Law, visits Tom at the orphanage. Despite the warning signs that Tom is super evil, Dumbledore invites him to Hogwarts. During his time at the school, Tom becomes a handsome and brilliant student and a favorite of Potions Master Horace Slughorn. But he also becomes a bigoted fascist who's drawn to super evil magic, I guess it runs in the family. He spends his free time in the restricted section of the library researching super evil things. After learning about his muggle heritage, Tom tracks down and murders his father and paternal grandparents at Riddle House in Little Hangleton. He reclaims an old heirloom of his mother's family, a ring that he wears around Hogwarts. Little does he know at the time that the ring contains the fabled Resurrection Stone. It's never specified, but Tom must have used the murder members of his Muggle family to fashion the stone into the first of his 7 Horcruxes later down the line. In 1942, after one of Slughorn's famous dinner parties, Tom stays behind. He probes the professor about the nature of Horcruxes, backup vessels for the soul made by killing another person. He floats the idea of splitting a soul into 7 fragments, and Slughorn is rightfully terrified, but he doesn't tell anyone about the incident. A year later, Tom discovers the Chamber of Secrets' hidden entrance. He frees Slytherin's basilisk so it can roam the halls of Hogwarts, killing Myrtle Warren. In the ensuing investigation, Tom blames Rubius Hagrid for opening the chamber. Hagrid's expelled and his wand is broken, but Dumbledore remains suspicious of Tom. Suffering under Dumbledore's watchful eye, Tom stops exploring the chamber and turns his personal diary into his 2nd Horcrux. In the following years, Tom creates 3 additional Horcruxes, further dividing his soul. In 1945, Dumbledore has a legendary duel against the dark wizard Gellert Grindelwald. That's literally a whole other story, but the main takeaway is that Dumbledore is victorious and seizes control of the Elder Wand from him. But now there's a new Dark Lord in town. At some additional point, Edgelord Tom Riddle thinks it would be cool to rearrange the letters in his name to make a Dark Lord title and takes the mantle of Lord Voldemort. The name matches his new, super creepy appearance. The severing of his soul drains Lord Voldemort of his humanity, leaving him pale and serpentine. Also, he has no nose, probably part of that whole looking like a snake thing, but he has no nose and it's weird and gross, but now whenever I see Ralph Fiennes, I don't recognize him because I mostly know him for having no nose. In this transformative time, Voldemort gains a legion of followers called Death Eaters who help him incite fear and discrimination in the wizarding world, and basically, he's the biggest threat to the wizarding world since Gellert Grindelwald. 1970 to 1990. It's a period of civil war. The Order of the Phoenix, founded by Albus, protects the Ministry of Magic from Voldemort's reign of terror. Elsewhere, a young muggle-born witch named Lily Evans is coming into her powers. She falls out of favor with her jealous sister Petunia, if Petunia ever favored her in the first place, but meets another magical boy named Severus Snape. The two become fast friends, but their relationship is put in jeopardy once school begins. The Sorting Hat sorts Lily into Gryffindor, while Snape is sorted into Slytherin. They're further estranged by the Marauders, a mischievous group of Gryffindor boys who bully Snape. They're made up of Sirius Black, Peter Pettigrew, Remus Lupin, and James Potter. All 4 boys are animagi, having learned how to transform into animals so that Lupin wouldn't have to feel so bad about being a werewolf, which is pretty sweet, actually. James eventually starts a relationship with Lily, and it completely alienates Snape. Though Snape is a proficient student, even marking up a potions textbook under the alias of the Half-Blood Prince, he's lonely. I mean, he was calling himself the Half-Blood Prince. It doesn't take a genius to see that someone like that is lonely. In his isolation, he turns to Lord Voldemort, becoming one of his Death Eaters. Conversely, Lily and the Marauders join the Order of the Phoenix to stand against the Dark Lord. Sirius Black's brother, Regulus Black, also becomes a Death Eater. He's a loyal servant to Voldemort until the Dark Lord uses Regulus's house elf creature for a trial run on a Horcrux challenge. Voldemort hides Salazar Slytherin's locket in the seaside cave from his childhood, protected by a poisonous potion that he makes the elf drink. Upon learning this, Regulus and creature go back to the cave and steal the locket. They leave behind a fake locket with a hidden note inside, presumably saying you got pranked underneath whatever the actual note said. But Regulus is killed by Inferni. Creature takes the real locket back to the Black family's ancestral home, but he's incapable of destroying it. In 1979, at the height of Lord Voldemort's power, Sybil Trelawney foresees his downfall. She recites a prophecy to Dumbledore at her Hogwarts job interview, stating that the one with the power to vanquish the Dark Lord approaches, born to those who have thrice defied him, born as the 7th month dies. Little do they realize that Severus Snape is on the other side of the door eavesdropping. He delivers the news directly back to Lord Voldemort, who determines that the defiers in question are Lily and James Potter and that the chosen one is their son Harry. The Dark Lord decides to track them down and kill them, but since Snape is still in love with Lily, he's like, oh boy, shouldn't have said that, so he rushes to Dumbledore to confess his sins. They concoct a plan to protect the Potters, but it fails when Peter Pettigrew gives in to Voldemort's influence and sells them out. On Halloween 1981, Voldemort invades Lily and James's house in Godric's Hollow and then murders them, and if you're doing the math here, that means that Lily and James were only 21 when they died? And there's also a non-zero chance that they were listening to Betty Davis Eyes when this all went down? Though Voldemort tries to kill Harry too, the boy is protected by love magic imparted by his mom as she sacrifices her life to save her son, so the spell backfires. Harry lives and Voldemort's body is vanquished. His soul survives though, thanks to his Horcruxes, and an additional soul fragment is imprinted into Harry through a forehead scar. It's in the shape of the Avada Kedavra hand motion, that being the spell that was used to murder Harry's family, but to the rest of us muggles, the scar just looks like a lightning bolt. Sirius Black realizes that Pettigrew betrayed the Potters and confronts him, but Pettigrew fakes his own death via explosion, implicating Sirius in the crimes, including selling out the Potters. Sirius is convicted and sent to Azkaban prison, while Pettigrew becomes a full-time rat for the little boys in the Weasley family. But honestly, being a rat would probably be an upgrade for me if I looked like this at age 21. Actually, didn't look that different. I'm gonna move on now. To allow Orphan Harry to grow up as normally as possible, Dumbledore Dumbledore sends him to live with his Aunt Petunia and Uncle Vernon Dursley in Little Whinging, England. They've got a son of their own named Dudley, and they're none too happy about having to raise this second cursed child. Turns out that maybe sending Harry to these folks might have maybe sort of been kind of a bad idea, since for the next 10 years, Harry grows up tormented by the Dursleys. They stow him away in a cupboard under the stairs and keep his entire magical history a secret from him. Meanwhile, Voldemort leads a cursed life of his own, surviving in a sub-spirit state in the forests of Albania, possessing snakes to survive. His followers are tried by the Ministry of Magic for their crimes. During his trial, Igor Karkaroff ousts Barty Crouch Jr. as a Death Eater. Crouch is sentenced to Azkaban, while Karkaroff becomes headmaster of the Durmstrang Institute. And Snape becomes a Hogwarts professor. And Lucius Malfoy remains the head of one of the richest wizarding families, and is there no justice? All of Voldemort's followers have turned their backs on him, but he's eventually discovered by Quirrell, a Muggle studies professor from Hogwarts with an unnatural interest in super evil arts. His lack of self-worth makes him susceptible to Voldemort's trickery, so the Dark Lord latches himself onto the back of Quirrell's head, concealed by a bright purple turban that's very inconspicuous. 1991 to 1992, Harry's first year at Hogwarts. In happier news, Harry Potter's life changes in the summer of 1991 when he receives his Hogwarts acceptance letter. Though the Dursleys go to the ends of the earth, literally, to keep Harry away from magic, Hagrid tracks them down and liberates the boy. He tells Harry about his historic backstory, including the fact that he's already a celebrity in the wizarding world for surviving Voldemort, and sets him up with all the back-to-school supplies he needs, including a beautiful snowy owl named Hedwig. I hope nothing happens to her. Along the way, they stop at Gringotts Wizarding Bank to withdraw the Philosopher's Stone, which is to be moved to Hogwarts for safekeeping. Once there, it will be magically contained within the Mirror of Erised, obtainable only by someone who is worthy. Also, Harry has like a million bazillion dollars in wizard money. On the Hogwarts Express, Harry meets Ron Weasley, with full-time rat Peter Pettigrew in his lap, though the Weasley family's taken to calling him Scabbers and Hermione Granger. After super rudely buying an entire train's worth of refreshments, they're his ride-or-die squad for his entire academic career. He sorted into Gryffindor and becomes a Quidditch jock, just like his father before him, though the Sorting Hat really said he could go to Gryffindor or Slytherin. It was kind of a toss-up, since Harry has part of the soul of an evil wizard embedded into his forehead, you know. Meanwhile, Quirrell and Voldemort learn that the Philosopher's Stone has been moved to Hogwarts. Using the stone's power, they'd be able to restore Voldemort to his full form, so they unleash a troll as a distraction while they try to retrieve it. It turns out that the stone is guarded by a three-headed dog named Fluffy, and Quirrell's two heads are no match for it. Harry and his cohorts come to suspect that it's actually Professor Snape who's trying to steal the stone, so they decide to steal it before he can. Thanks to Hagrid's loose lips, they're able to get past Fluffy and the other trials, but their numbers dwindle along the way until only Harry is left standing. Ron and Hermione are fine, though, whatever. He confronts Quirrell and Voldemort at the Mirror of Erised, which senses his selfless motives and rewards him with the stone. When Quirrell tries to snatch it from him, Harry disintegrates him with love magic, and Voldemort's fragmented soul flies off to fight another day, screaming, "We'll meet again, Spider-Man," or whatever. In the aftermath of the incident, Dumbledore destroys the Philosopher's Stone, bringing an eventual end to Nicholas Flamel's long life. And then he totally cheats Slytherin out of the House Cup by awarding Gryffindor with 170 house points for at the award ceremony, because the system is rigged, and it's 1992 to 1993. That summer, Lucius Malfoy begins a campaign to reopen the Chamber of Secrets and purge Hogwarts of its Muggle-born and half-blood students. His house elf, Dobby, finds out about the scheme and tries to protect Harry from it. He ostracizes the boy from Hogwarts by withholding all of the letters from his friends and by sealing up the gateway to Platform 9 and 3 quarters, you know, the platform at King's Cross that leads to the train. With a little help from Ron's flying car, Harry makes it to school with only a few scratches and a little detention. But the plan's already in motion. Lucius pawns off Voldemort's diary, the first Horcrux, onto Ron's sister Ginny. The diary brainwashes Ginny into reopening the chamber and unleashing the basilisk, which traverses the halls, petrifying a handful of the student body, including Hermione. Knowing that the chamber can only be opened by Slytherin's heir, the school goes into a whodunit frenzy of finding the culprit until Ginny vanishes completely. Harry and Ron follow a lead from Moaning Myrtle, ghost of Myrtle Warren, the student that the basilisk killed all those years ago. Harry and Ron venture into the Chamber of Secrets to find Ginny there, only to come face to face with Tom Riddle himself. Luckily, Dumbledore's Phoenix Fox delivers the Sword of Gryffindor to Harry at a crucial moment and uses it to slay the snake monster. That supercharges it with basilisk venom, which becomes important later. Then, using the basilisk's fang, Harry stabs and destroys the diary, destroying the first fragment of Voldemort's soul. Oh, and also, Gilderoy Lockhart was the Defense Against the Dark Arts teacher that year, but you can just forget about him. Whatever, it's not important. He directed the first Thor, he's doing fine. 1993 to 1994. After spending 12 years in Azkaban, Sirius Black learns that Peter Pettigrew is still alive and attending Hogwarts as a full-time rat. Sirius uses his shape-shifting abilities to escape the inescapable prison as a dog, and then swims back to shore to track down his old friend. Since the general public still believes that Sirius betrayed the Potters, they all believe that Harry is his target. The Ministry of Magic deploys the soul-sucking Dementors to recapture Sirius before he gets to the boy. But the Dementors board the Hogwarts Express and feed feed on all of Harry's angst, but he's saved by Remus Lupin. He's the new Defense Against the Dark Arts teacher, and he gives Harry private lessons on the Patronus Charm, the spell used to repel Dementors. In other Hogwarts news, Professor McGonagall gives Hermione a rare time turner so that she can take extra classes, which is the lamest excuse to use time travel ever, but whatever. And Draco Malfoy harasses a Fantastic Beast named Buckbeak and gets bucked himself, and since Draco is too rich to take responsibility for his actions, his daddy has Buckbeak sentenced to death. Before Buckbeak is executed, future Harry and future Hermione appear via the time turner and save him. Before any of that happened, though, as the present-day trio helplessly watched the would-be execution, full-time rat Peter Pettigrew bites Ron and flees into the woods. The friends chase him, but they're intercepted by Sirius Black, who drags Ron into the Shrieking Shack. Once they're all inside, Lupin joins them and explains that this has all been a misunderstanding, as Sirius is actually just trying to kill Ron's family pet. They forcibly revert Pettigrew back to human form and take him toward the castle, but it's bad timing, though, because it's a full moon, so Lupus goes beast mode and messes everything up. Pettigrew escapes while Harry and Sirius are accosted by Dementors until future Harry appears and vanquishes them with a Patronus charm, but present Harry doesn't know it's his future self who sends the silvery stag yet, because he hasn't done it yet, to him. Whatever, Sirius Black is captured and then sentenced to death, so Harry and Hermione use the time turner to go back in time and do all of those things that I just explained. That was like the most confusing explanation ever. I hate explaining time travel. Everybody got that? 1994 to 1995. Having escaped from Harry and his friends, Pettigrew creates a rudimentary, childlike body for Voldemort. Gross. Pettigrew and Proto-Voldemort take refuge at the old Riddle House. Caretaker Frank Bryce investigates the disturbance at the abandoned manor, so Voldemort kills him. He then turns Nagini into his seventh Horcrux. Afterward, Barty Crouch Jr. and a band of Death Eaters terrorize the Quidditch World Cup, where Harry and his friends just happen to be. Around that time, the Death Eaters abduct the Auror, Mad-Eye, Moody, and Crouch uses a Polyjuice potion to take his place. Naturally, Moody becomes the new Defense Against the Dark Arts teacher, actually Crouch. This year, the school is hosting the Triwizard Tournament for the first time in 200 years, and they're pretty sure it won't be too dangerous. Students who are over the age of 17 can submit their names into the Goblet of Fire, which will then select one champion from each of the three schools. The Death Eaters didn't get the memo about the rules, though, so fake Moody puts Harry's name in the cup. It selects him as a fourth contestant, along with the actual Hogwarts champion, Cedric Diggory. Dumbledore asks him, calmly,
"How did you put your name in the Goblet of Fire?"
But in the end, it doesn't matter, because rules, Harry is contractually obligated to compete, just as the Death Eaters intended. The Triwizard Tournament carries on, with each challenge more dangerous than the last, but Moody rigs it so that Harry is guaranteed to win. The final task is to find the Triwizard Cup within a hedge maze. Kind of underwhelming after all of the other challenges, honestly. At the end of the maze, Harry and Cedric agree to grab the cup together, but the cup's been enchanted into a teleportation device called a portkey, and it whisks them away to a graveyard. Peter Pettigrew and Voldemort await Harry there. They quickly dispose of Cedric. He's dead, but whatever, it's cool. He's a vampire or Batman or something. The two then use Harry in a ritual that resurrects Voldemort. He summons all of his Death Eaters and publicly shames them before turning his attention back to Harry. The Dark Lord initiates a duel to prove himself superior to his adversary. Harry whips out the only spell he's half decent at, Expelliarmus, which meets Voldemort's Avada Kedavra. The spells collide in a Dragon Ball Z beam struggle that frees the echoes of Voldemort's victims. Harry's parents, Frank Bryce, and Cedric Diggory keep the Dark Lord at bay while Harry flees the graveyard with Cedric's body. Upon his return to Hogwarts, Harry and the professors expose Crouch disguised as Moody and find the real one alive, trapped in a magic chest. 1995 to 1996. Despite Harry's first-hand encounter with Voldemort, the Ministry of Magic refuses to acknowledge that the Dark Lord has returned, even though he very much has. And he's rebuilding his army by freeing prisoners from Azkaban, something that the Ministry is pinning on Sirius, and he's looking to correct the failure that led to his downfall. To that end, he and the Death Eaters are after the prophecy that first predicted his defeat. Back at Hogwarts, the Ministry designates the worst villain in the history of the Harry Potter series, Dolores Umbridge, as the new Defense Against the Dark Arts teacher, but she shares their denial of climate change. I mean, Voldemort's return. Since she won't actually teach her students how to defend themselves against the dark arts, Harry and his friends do it instead. They start Dumbledore's Army, a wizarding fight club to prepare for the inevitable battle. And for snogging. It was unavoidable. Their training pays off when Harry has a vision of Sirius being tortured by Voldemort. It's a trap meant to lure them to the Ministry of Magic, and it works. They find the prophecy there, but they're hoodwinked by Lucius Malfoy. He threatens to kill them all if Harry doesn't relinquish the prophecy. Before the deal is done, the Order of the Phoenix arrives, led by Sirius Black, and dukes it out with the Death Eaters. In the fray, the prophecy shatters, and Sirius is killed by his cousin, Bellatrix Lestrange. Harry pursues her to exact his revenge, but he's waylaid by Voldemort. The Dark Lord has the upper hand this time, but luckily, Dumbledore arrives to protect the boy. The two master wizards duel in a spectacular battle, and just as it comes to a close, the wizarding workday begins, and all of the Ministry officials flood in. They witness Voldemort in the flesh, proving once and for all that he's back, which is like the wildest way to start start your work week, I probably would have taken the day off. 1996 to 1997. Following the loss of the prophecy, Voldemort inducts Draco Malfoy into the Death Eaters and tasks him with assassinating Dumbledore. That would bring the Malfoy family back into his good graces. Snape tattles to Dumbledore, but finds that the headmaster's been cursed after destroying one of Voldemort's horcruxes, the Resurrection Stone Ring. With Dumbledore's life already on the line, the two of them agree that Snape should be the one to kill Dumbledore. In anticipation of his death, Dumbledore packs the Resurrection Stone into the snitch from Harry's first Quidditch game to be posthumously gifted to him. Harry's sixth year at Hogwarts is filled with teen drama and magical hijinks and more snogging, and there's this mystery about this half-blood prince bloke, but eventually he and Dumbledore get down to business. The headmaster has located a third horcrux in the seaside cave from Tom Riddle's childhood. Not realizing that the locket is a fake, they retrieve it, barely escaping with their lives. Upon their return to Hogwarts, they find that it's been raided by Death Eaters. Harry hides while Dumbledore faces them. At the Astronomy Tower, Draco disarms the headmaster, making him the master of the Elder Wand, but he can't bring himself to kill Dumbledore and chickens out at the last second. So, one of the most infamous spoilers of all time happens, and Snape kills Dumbledore. As the Death Eaters pillage Hogwarts, the students and teachers mourn the headmaster's death. 1997 to 1998. Voldemort continues his new reign of terror. To keep Harry safe from it, the Order of the Phoenix deliver him to the Weasley's home at the Burrow, but there are casualties along the way. Rest in peace, Mad-Eye. We hardly even knew the real you. And also, whoops, something happened to Hedwig. Harry's determined to continue Dumbledore's quest for the Horcruxes, but Ron convinces him to stay for his brother's wedding. Well, the wedding gets ransacked by Death Eaters anyway, so the questing begins. The trio heads to the Black family's ancestral home and meets Creature. They learn that Creature had the real locket, but it was stolen by Mundungus Fletcher, who gave it to Dolores Umbridge, who is working in the corrupt ministry. So, like, they go and get that. For months, the gang stays camped out in the wilderness, hiding from Death Eaters while trying to destroy the locket. All the while, Voldemort's siege of the Wizarding World continues. Now, Turncoat Snape has even taken over as headmaster of Hogwarts. The situation looks grim, but Snape pulls through for the good guys. He stealthily withdraws the supercharged sword of Gryffindor from Bellatrix's bank vault and deposits it within a frozen lake. Then, lures Harry over using a Patronus charm. Ron strikes the locket with the blade and destroys it, weakening the Dark Lord. But old Tom is feeling alright since he goes grave digging and steals the Elder Wand from Dumbledore's tomb. Though they've been cautious, Harry and his friends are captured by Snatchers and brought to Malfoy Manor. Before the Death Eaters can do their thing, though, Dobby apparates in and jailbreaks the trio. In the ensuing battle, Harry disarms Draco, so now he's the master of the Elder Wand, keep track. They apparate away from the manor, but Bellatrix sneaks a killing blow on Dobby. With four Horcruxes left to go, Harry, Ron, and Hermione hit up Gringotts Bank and the Room of Requirement at Hogwarts. They destroy one of the hidden objects using Fiendfire, and the other with a Basilisk Fang from the Chamber of Secrets, so it's all coming full circle now. And then there's more snogging, though seriously, everyone knows that the real ship is Ron and Harry. Voldemort grows wise to the trio's questing, so he sends the Death Eaters to raid the school. The attack becomes known as the Battle of Hogwarts, and many great witches and wizards die in the epic confrontation, and Molly Weasley gets to deliver her iconic line, channeling her inner Ellen Ripley.
Not my daughter, you bitch.
Elsewhere, Voldemort is under the impression that Snape is the proper master of the Elder Wand, since he was the one who killed Dumbledore, unaware that Draco became the master beforehand. So he sixes Snake Nagini on him. Sidebar, Nagini used to be a human woman, but that's a whole other thing. Through Snape's memories, Harry learns that a piece of Voldemort lives inside of him and that he must die to destroy it, so, like, he does that. But Voldemort's killing curse only affects his own soul, not Harry, so the boy who lived returns for the final battle. When Neville Longbottom heroically kills Nagini, it makes Voldemort completely vulnerable. The Dark Lord tries to use the Elder Wand to defeat Harry, its true master, and it rejects his spell, obliterating him. With Voldemort fully extinguished from the earth, the Death Eaters disband once again, and Hogwarts rebuilds. 1998 to 2017. In the years following the Battle of Hogwarts, Harry becomes an Auror and brings the corrupt Ministry of Magic back to its former glory. Not bad for a high school dropout. He marries Ginny Weasley, and they have three ridiculously named children together. Likewise, Ron and Hermione marry with children and pick up lofty government jobs at the Ministry, so it's a happy ending all around. All is well. And then the cursed child happened, but let's not. I've been your host, Jacob, and thanks for watching. What was your biggest accomplishment in high school? Did you ever stop a decades-long reign of evil, or did high school just feel like one? Let us know in the comments, and as always, be sure to subscribe to Cinematica for more timelines just like this one.